Joan Johnson Lewis, and I'm the interim clergy leader here at Brooklyn Society for Ethical Culture. I want to just say a few words before we start about coming of age as a program. When I was a kid, I actually was myself a second generation humanist, and we didn't have anything like coming of age when I was growing up. And I just sort of dropped out of Sunday school, and that was it. I really appreciate that in the years since then, we have come, even in our non-traditional ethical society, to understand that there is a real shift and transition in life at this age. That you folks who are sitting here in the front row are not the little kids that many of us remember. You're not even the middle-sized kids we remember. You have a different level of ability to think about ethics, to make choices in your life. The choices you're making now are really important often in how you will shape your life. And so it's really important that we as a community acknowledge that. And I will also say from my own perspective as a parent who had two sons who went through coming of ages, that to you who are here as parents, that this is really an opportunity for you to sit back and acknowledge that your child is not so much a child anymore. They're not the little kid. They're also not quite an adult yet. That's a different coming of age. But they are different. And it helps us as parents to have a tradition like this, a ceremony like this, to remind us that we have these young adults now in our families. So we're going to begin this afternoon's program with Dupre and Barry offering us some music.
This is a Rod Stewart song. Some of you will be familiar. Feel free to join in. This song is dedicated to all of the graduates here. Older students will definitely understand these lyrics. It's been a long road getting from there to here. It's been a long time, but my time is finally here. And I can feel a change in the wind right now. Nothing in my way, and they're not gonna hold me down no more. No, they're not gonna hold me down, 'cause I got faith of the heart. I'm going where my heart will take me. I got faith to believe I can do anything. I've got strength of the soul. No one's gonna bend or break me. I can reach any star. I got faith. I got faith. Faith of the heart. It's been a long night trying to find my way. Then through the darkness, now I finally have my day. I can see my dreams come alive at last. Nothing in my way, and they're not gonna hold me down no more. No, they're not gonna hold me down, 'cause I got faith of the heart. Knowing where my heart will take me, I got faith to believe can do anything. I've got the strength of the soul. No one's gonna bend or break me. I can reach any star.
Barry Kornhauser on guitar.
Thank you for that beautiful music, Dupre. Hi, everybody. My name is Leah. I'm the director of the Ethics for Children program here at the Brooklyn Society for Ethical Culture. And I've also had the privilege of leading the coming of age group for these last 2 years. And so we have five children presenting today. Four of them are graduating, and they have been in this program for many years, some of them for their entire lives, so this is a big moment. I'm so proud of each of them and really excited for you to see all of the deep thinking and hard work they've done on these topics that they're going to present to you today. So I'm going to jump right in. We're going to start with, we have one student that has another year left, Tyler Hampton. He's going to graduate next year. But I really wanted encouraged him to present today because he has just so much insight and talent to offer. So I just want to say a few words about Tyler before I call him up here. Tyler has a big heart and a sharp mind. He has a natural skill with language, and he is a talented visual artist, as you will all see. Tyler has the ability to remain centered and calm, even when life throws him a curveball. Tyler is also curious, respectful, brave, expressive, and always willing to try new things. So even though Tyler is just halfway through his coming of age, I'm so looking forward to seeing what he will do as he grows and matures, and so excited for you to see what he's been working on. So Tyler Hampton, please come up to the podium.
Hello, everybody. My name is Tyler Hampton. I'm 13 years old, and the title I chose for my topic is Refugees Are Human Too. Thank you. Next slide, please. Why I chose this topic? I chose this topic because immigration, especially having to do with refugees, is a big issue in our society. Refugees deserve our compassion, generosity, and the opportunity for a new start. For my presentation on refugees, I decided to draw some sketches. I made four sketches on my topic. In this first picture, I drew someone in whose eye is the reflection of two people who present danger to her and her family. She is scared, sad, and worried because she lives in a dangerous and violent country and she does not feel safe. Refugees in many areas cannot rely on being safe. Next slide, please. In my second sketch, there is a picture of a young girl. She is hoping for an end to all the chaos in the place where she lives. Did you know approximately 65 million people in the world are refugees and half of them are children? Next slide, please. My third drawing is of our current president, who I think does not care for others in need. He wants to prevent immigrants and refugees from many places from coming into the country, especially from majority Muslim countries. Next slide, please. And in this sketch, there is a mother taking care of her baby while trying to get through life in these horrible conditions. In this refugee camp, people live in tents and there is much poverty there. It is hard in these conditions for people to take care of themselves and their families. Families want safety and better lives for themselves and their people. This leads to them to want to move to a better place where they can be free from war, hunger, and fear. Next slide, please. So I believe that all human beings are equal and should be treated as equals with the same rights and freedoms, no matter where they are from. Thank you.
So Zane is a guy you don't meet every day. I've learned over the years that if you ask Zane a question, no matter how seemingly straightforward, you will never be able to predict his answer. His outside-the-box thinking has inspired us to laugh in every single class and to remember the absurdity of life. He does this while keeping a totally straight face, which I find very impressive. Zane is talented in multiple art forms, including visual arts, filmmaking, and editing. Zane never ceases to surprise me. His creative mind and technical talent is sure to take him to interesting places in his life. So, come on up, Zane.
Okay, so, my name is Zane Devlin, as you know. The topic I chose to do for the coming of age was endangered animals. I don't exactly know how I got inspired to do this topic, but animals just always really I always just really liked animals, and so it just really made me think about them. By beginning this project, I started by making lists of animals from most endangered to least endangered, and a few others such as extinction lists and a few other lists that I made. But I chose one list, and I started by doing sketches of the top five. I didn't do one of them because the animal was really hard to draw, So this was the first one I did, was the northern white rhino. It's the most, probably one of the most endangered animals in the entire world. There's only four left alive today. There's three females, one male, and the male is unable to mate, so they don't have any hope left to survive. The species is only so endangered because of a thing called poaching, which people do in Africa to get money. It's when they kill animals, for mostly rhinos and elephants, for their horns, because their horns are one horn can be worth up to $250,000 on the black market. So that's why they're so endangered, and there's an estimation that the entire rhino species could be extinct within 10 years or less. And there's a few other things about this rhino. I mean, I studied this one more because I did a project in school on it, but yeah. Next slide. The next drawing that I drew was the vaquita. When I was researching this project, this animal, I thought it was a dolphin. It was not. It was a whale, actually. I'm pretty sure it's the smallest whale in the world. It lives in this. It lives in the Gulf of California, and they're 5 feet long, and they can weigh up to 120 pounds. When I saw it, I thought it was like a person holding it. I thought it was like a baby dolphin, but it was a full-sized whale. It was suspected that they would be extinct within 2018, but when there was around 100 left in 2015, but now there's around 30 left, and they're still slowly going down because of fishing nets and other fishing equipment that has endangered these. But you know, it's really hard to tell with this species because it's a marine life, and we've only discovered less than 5% of the ocean. So the next animal that I researched was the Amur leopard. The Amur leopard is a leopard that traveled east from China and Russia, and they traveled east to China and Russia. And it's one of the only leopards that has ever left Africa, the African area, and adapted to a Russian and Chinese climate. There are only around 40 left in the world, and it's one of the few species that stay where the male and the female stay with the children to help them grow up. And they live for 10 to 15 years in the wild, but in captivity for up to 20. Males weigh from 71 to 106 pounds, and females from 55 to 94 pounds. They are predators. They're also known as the Far East leopard, the Manchurian leopard, and the Korean leopard. Next slide. The next animal that I researched and drew was the brown spider monkey. It comes from forests in North Colombia and northwestern Venezuela. Their tail works as a fifth limb because it's highly flexible, and I'm pretty sure they can balance on it and swing with it. Males weigh between 17 and 20 pounds, and adult females weigh between 17 and 20 pounds. Their average body length, adult body length, is about 20 inches. It has a very long spindly limbs. They're estimated to be 60 left in the world, and their real name is Atelius hybridus. They communicate through screeches and other noises, and females give birth to one baby every 2 to 5 years. They're going extinct because of pollution to the forests and tree cutting down. I took all these photos, and I took liberty into making it into one big photo. I tried to make it seem as if they were all one big family, and that you can't really just not care about them. They're just animals. You can't think like that. You have to think like, these are just like us. They have the same mind as us. They have the same mind as us, and they have they think, and they have a heart. They have a brain. They are just as much as you and I are. So I tried to make it look like as if they were one big family. Like they live in one big same world. So that's the picture. And those are some. Thank you for listening.
Jahai Bandele is up next. Jahai is a deep thinker. He is mature beyond his years, to the point that I have to remind myself sometimes that I am talking to a 14-year-old, not a 34-year-old. Jahai has an unusual passion for grappling with difficult subjects and articulating their complexities, particularly on social issues such as racism, sexism, and homophobia. Jahai has a great willingness to dive in, investigate, and discuss. He is also a good friend and a dedicated son and brother. Over the years, I've watched Jahai and his hair grow, expand, and mature. I am sure that Jahai will contribute greatly to the betterment of our world and will help others to think more deeply and critically about our culture and our world at large. Jahai Bandele.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jahai Bandele, and my presentation will be about the ethics in hip-hop. Wayside side piece. So in case the title actually confuses you, what my presentation is actually going to be about is differentiating between ethical and unethical hip-hop artists. I think that since hip-hop has ascended to a pretty high level of popularity, it's important to analyze its values through its lyrics, since it's one of the most lyrical genres of music. Next slide, please. So my first experience listening to hip-hop is when my dad exposed me to a song called Rapper's Delight by Sugar Hill Gang. And that song was more about beat and sound quality, and it led me to listen to more mainstream rap throughout my younger years. However, as I grew older, I found a newfound appreciation for deep, witty, or creative lyrics, and that led my favorite artists to become Kendrick Lamar, Joey Badass, Joyner Lucas, and Biggie Smalls. So the evolution of hip-hop kind of parallels my experience to it, as it started off as party music, and it lacked really any message in its lyrics. However, as hip-hop progressed into the 90s, which is considered like the golden age of rap music, rappers like Biggie Smalls, Tupac, and Big Pun were regarded as amazing lyricists and helped the genre become popular. However, hip-hop has had a share of controversy, as it's been criticized for popularizing the ideas of people who are materialistic, shallow, and misogynistic most commonly. However, some artists who are even seen as racist or homophobic have found popularity through hip-hop. So what I did with this, kind of delving deep into hip-hop was take two unethical artists and two ethical rap artists and analyzing different lyrics from each of them. And the first one I dove into was Eminem, and he's extremely popular as he's had two diamond albums, which means selling over 10 million copies, seven platinum albums, which means selling over 1 million copies, and Billboard's number 3 rank on the greatest rappers of all times list. Here's a snippet of his music.
Easy on you, not to hurt your feelings, but I'm only going to get this one chance. I can feel it.
It's just a feeling I've got. Like something's about to happen, but I don't know what.
If that means what I think it means, we're in trouble. Big trouble. And if he is bananas, as you say, I'm not taking any chances.
You're just one of
the stars. I'm beginning to feel like a rap god, rap god. All my people from the front to the back, nod, back, nod. Now who thinks their arms are long enough to slap box, slap box? They said I rap like a robot, so call me rap. But for me to rap like a...
So yeah, that's just how he sounds as an artist. So what I did with him is him and all my unethical artists is I chose three lyrics and basically surveyed people about how they felt. And I'm not going to say the lyrics because they are a bit grave, gruesome, whatever, but I will give a brief description of each. The first lyric is actually on the screen, as it's extremely homophobic, as he throws around this gay slur fag a bunch of times and just outright says he hates fags. The second lyric invokes two horrific scenarios, as the first is him choking a woman out and the second is him having sex with his own mother. And the last lyric I chose shows him throwing around another homosexual slur, dyke, and then comparing his abuse of another woman to the Ray Rice case. And for those who don't know what that case is, it's when Ray Rice was charged with assault and domestic violence against his own wife. And the response that I got from the interviewees had one quote which was very powerful to me, and it was, "It's scary that adults believe that misogyny and homophobia is what will sell to teens and young adults, and if this isn't indicative of a Trump era, I don't know what is." So the second unethical artist I dove into was Lil Wayne, and just to get a sense of how successful he is, he's had six gold albums, three, which means selling over 250,000 copies, three platinum albums, and a number 10 spot on Billboard's Greatest Rappers of All Time list. Here's a little snippet of his music.
Young money militia, and I am that commissioner. You don't want to start wheezing, cause the F is my finisher. So misunderstood, but what's the world without enigma? Two bitches at the same time, synchronized.
So I did the same thing with Eminem, where I took some of his most gruesome lyrics and surveyed people about them. So the first lyric I chose is by Lil Wayne, who jokingly compares his rough sex to the brutal murder of an African-American boy named Emmett Till, who was lynched in 1955 for flirting with a white woman. The next lyric I chose depicted sexual intercourse during an abusive relationship. Also in the video for this song, he has women in the video wearing stylized versions of Scold's bridles, as you can see up there. There, the one on the right is the one Lil Wayne has them wearing the video, and the one on the left is the medieval torture device. Previous slide, please. And the last lyric I chose wasn't really a lyric, but a comment regarding Black Lives Matter, where he says, "I don't feel connected to a damn thing that ain't got to do with me," basically dismissing the activist movement. And like Eminem, the response from the interviewees had one quote that was moving, which was, "He somewhat represents some way of thinking for young black men. When the cops come, they don't shoot him, they shoot the young black male whose life is already justified for the taking." Next slide. So now I'd like to introduce the subgenre of conscious rap, and this subgenre revolves around rappers writing lyrics about social problems that go on in the world. The most popular of these artists is on the screen right there, Tupac Shakur. However, since his death, other artists have kept this subgenre popular. Next slide, please. So the first ethical artist I chose was J. Cole. As you get a sense of how successful he is, he had 14 top 40 hits, and all four of his albums have gone platinum. One has gone double platinum with no features, which is actually pretty remarkable. Next slide, please. So J. Cole raps about many different social issues, such as race, true love, and even abortion. This can be shown in his lyrics, as his first lyric up there is about how he has a crooked smile, and now that he's rich, people tell him to fix it. However, he's accepted his crooked smile, it's just who he is as a person, and even embraces it since he's achieved so much success with having a crooked smile. The second lyric I chose is truly a whole song, which I found pretty interesting because it was a conversation between a man and a woman on both sides of abortion, the man wanting to abort the baby because he can't provide for it and he knows the family can't provide for it, but the woman wanting to keep the baby alive because it's his life. Her life, my bad. So Rolling Stone even praised J. Cole as they say that his last album was a well-executed meditation on love, loss, fatherhood, and being black in America. So the second ethical artist I chose was Lupe Fiasco. However, he hasn't really panned out with much success. He's only had 2 top 10 hits, 2 gold albums, and his biggest hit that he ever had was a push from his record label. The record label made him do it to sound more mainstream. How his lack of success isn't surprising, as the messages he talks about are, in my opinion, too real for the American mainstream to stomach, as the first lyric shows him talking about how the Europeans who founded America committed genocide against the Native Americans, and how no one speaks of Columbus and his followers as villains, rather as heroes. And the second lyric shows how language and media culture affect the youth, specifically how young women view, specifically one young women and how they view themselves. However, critics still dismiss Lupe as a Masupe as a website called Lupe's Music Half-Baked Conscious Hip-Hop, which basically means that they find Lupe's music pseudo-intellectual and that he really doesn't talk about anything important. Next slide, please. So where I am with hip-hop right now. So despite my phase where I really didn't pay attention to lyrics and stumbled upon artists such as Lil Wayne and Eminem, my newfound appreciation for lyrics has opened me up to rappers who are killing it because of positive and deep lyrics such as Logic, J. Cole, Kendrick Lamar, Schoolboy Q, and others. Also, ironically, most of the bad artists today like pay no attention to lyrics, so they say nothing important and inherently nothing offensive. I'm even part of a rap group called Antidote with my friends, and we're planning to drop an album this summer.
Okay, next up we have Cece Servan. I have a few words to say about Cece. Cece, I was trying to think of how to describe Cece, one word came to my mind, and I thought, oh, this could be the whole thing. And it was a force. Okay, that's 2 words, but Cece is a force. She is determined, strong, whip smart, cultured, articulate, and I'd even go as far as to say fearless, or at least she seems so to me. She is not afraid to speak her mind or to pursue alternative paths in life. She is passionate about social justice and music and has managed to combine those talents. Already at a young age, Cece is a beautiful expression of female power. Cece Servan.
Okay, so my project was on feminism and punk. By the way, I'm Cece Servan and I'm 14 years old. Next slide. So the inspiration for this project was that I've been listening to punk since I asked for my first album, a Ramones compilation, when I was 5 years old. I've been into the Ramones as well as other punk bands like The Clash and The Dead Kennedys forever, and they inspired me to play music myself. However, most of the bands I was exposed to when I was little were all male. Then, on my 10th birthday, my Uncle Rich gave me a mixed CD of bands with girl drummers, and my babysitter gave me a CD of this band called Slater Kenny, who were an all-girl band from the late 90s and early 2000s. I think this subconsciously told me that I could play music too. I was already drumming, but I joined my first band later that year. Next slide, please. Last spring, I read a book called Girls to the Front by Sarah Marcus, which was about the Riot Girl movement, which was a feminist punk movement in the 90s. That put stories and faces to the bands off of my CD. I started looking more into feminist punk. When the time came to choose a project, this seemed like an obvious choice. Next slide. So punk is a genre of music and a subculture that originated in the 70s, mostly in New York with bands like the Ramones, the Dead Boys, and Patti Smith, and London where the Damn, the Sex Pistols, and the Clash came from. Here's an example of an early punk show. It's of the Dead Boys, and just watch what the crowd is doing. So as you can see, the crowd is pretty much just like moving along to the music and watching what's happening on stage. So in theory, punk is open to all outsiders. However, this hasn't always been the case. In the early 80s, more hardcore bands like Black Flag and TSOL started coming onto the scenes. Their shows were full of slam dancing and testosterone, which pushed out the original outsiders, many of which were women. Here's an example of a show by the band The Misfits. And just look at the kind of people in the crowd and also what they're doing. So as you can see, the audience in this show is much more violent, and they're also all white men. A lot of them are like not wearing shirts, and they're like pushing each other around and stuff. After that, in the 90s, the first well-known girl-dominated punk movement happened. It included bands like Bikini Kill, Bratmobile, Tuscadero, and Team Dresh. And I have an example of a Bikini Kill show here. And just watch how much their singer, Kathleen Hanna, is talking to the audience and the way she interacts with them, and also what kind of people are in the audience and what they're doing.
Bullshit, because we're all in different places right now. And then there's poor girls who get a whole different thing of usually getting reputations as sluts a lot easier than rich girls do. And there's all different kinds of stuff to do with race and class and gender. And my sister is here today, and when guys used to say stuff to her at the bus stop, we used to live in Chevy Chase and by the metro, then she used to reply with this, and this song is for her because she wrote it.
So as you can see, Kathleen Hanna is trying to cater a show not just to white straight men, but also people who aren't as in as good of an economic station, and also women more. So although most of those bands in those movements have broken up, punk still lives on today in bands like Speedy Ortiz, Taco Cat, The Screaming Females, and The Coat Hangers. Even better, there are more people who aren't just straight white men in the scene than ever before. Some of the cities with the best punk scenes now are Portland, Philadelphia, and Brooklyn. Here I have a video of, go to the next video, of the band The Screaming Females covering a Misfits song, which was the second to last band you saw. And just also watch the crowd here, and yeah. So you can see here that the crowd is slightly more violent, but I do know from experience at Screaming Female shows that the band tries their best to contain the crowd, and they really don't allow you to do anything too crazy other than some jumping around because they really want it to be a safe place for everyone. So for my project, I did a lot of research. I read a lot of books, I watched movies, and I listened to a lot of music. But the best part was I got to interview a bunch of very cool people. I talked to all kinds of people from photographers who were part of the CBs, GB scene in the 70s to pioneering 90s riot girls to people in some of the world's best modern punk bands. They all had amazing stories to tell. I'm now making a website to publish these interviews as well as other thoughts on feminism and punk. Next, please. I learned a lot of things from this project. I know a lot more about music than I did a few months ago. I've also discovered some pretty awesome bands that I wouldn't have known about otherwise. Most importantly, I have learned that punk is a very accessible scene. Before doing this project, I listened to music and went to shows, but I thought if I ever met my heroes, it would be when I was older. Now I've met all kinds of incredible people just by putting myself out there. I also think I've become a better musician because a lot of the people I interviewed were very inspiring. In fact, my album came out on June 9th, and yeah. I think the number one thing you can do is to get involved in your local scene, whether that's by starting a band or writing a zine or putting on shows. The great thing about punk is that it's all about attitude, so it doesn't really matter if you're any good. If you want to use music to make a difference, you could put on a benefit concert. I also talked to one person that said they never specify the genders in their of the characters in their songs so that everyone can relate. The most important thing to do is just get involved. And I have a clip of one of my band shows a couple weeks ago when we played a street fair. Thank you.
And we have one student left, Lachlan Brooks. Lachlan is a hard worker with a heart full of love that he is not afraid to express. He has both incredible physical strength and a deep inner strength of character. He is not concerned with what anyone says about him, and he is willing to speak up for others if they are being put down or treated unfairly. His sense of justice comes from his heart. He is deeply empathetic, a dear friend, and a loving brother and son. Over the years, watching the little ways that Lachlan cares for his friends and family has made me feel hopeful about humanity. Lachlan has grown into a caring, strong, and bright young adult who has stepped up into his new level of responsibility as a pre-professional ballet dancer with grace, humility, and gratitude. Lachlan Brooks.
Hi, how's everyone doing? Not too cold in here? Oh. Well, my name's Lachlan, if you don't already know. I'm 14 years old. I've been coming to ethical practically my whole life, from the first day I came to New York City. And my project is on the homeless, and America can't be like this. Yeah, my project is on the homeless in New York City. I came up with this title because we have people, not even people, we have humans on these streets, these dirty New York City streets, and it shouldn't be like this because we're all the same. And yeah. My mom and I signed up for homeless, helping out at soup kitchens here in New York City, Coney Island, Far Rockaway, and Chelsea, Manhattan, through a program called New York Cares. This program is a volunteer program where you can go help out, and ever since I started, I've been focusing more when I've been seeing homeless people on the streets and people in need. Next slide, please. Each shelter had a different impact on me, and I'm going to share what I experienced in each one. All right, so the first one was Coney Island slide. This was in January. It's pretty cold. It was during the winter. And the first rule to all service shelters was there was no photography. And this was probably the smaller side of soup kitchens. There were five other people helping out. And The job I was given was to give out the plates, and before we served the people, we got to eat the food, because the lady said that we get hungry serving the food, and I got hungry, so I'm pretty happy that she gave me the food. And it was pretty good. I remember it was like meatloaf, corn, mashed potatoes, gravy chicken, but they also had a vegan option, because we don't all eat meat, just like my dad. A lot of them are very polite. They've been waiting out there practically whole night, and when they're in the cold, and they lined up, they came in, and who's been waiting the longest, who just came, and I said thank you, God bless you, and it was just such a nice, such a great time, like helping out. And when it came to the end, it was kind of sad, because they went out to the harsh, cold winter conditions, and this is on Coney Island. This is where near the water, so there's a wind chill, and most of them weren't really properly prepared for this weather. Some of them were wearing shorts, some of them didn't have socks on, some didn't even have clothes on. Well, a coat. Next slide, please. The next one was the Xavier Parish Shelter. This was in February. It was like 28 degrees on that day. It was freezing. And this is one of the biggest shelters out in New York City. So the job I was given was to give out trays again, and there was a lot more. There was about 200 people who showed up, and this one homeless guy asked me to sit down with him. He started talking about his life. He said that he ran away from home when he was around like 18 years old. He was a teenager, and he was having a hard life at home. He was depressed. He couldn't live with his parents anymore. It was just really hard for him. And so he stole money from his parents and ran away into the city. And he said he thought he could keep that money by spending on food, water, things that he really needed. But instead, he got more depressed and ended up spending on drugs and alcohol and things that were really not good for him. He told me to lift up his backpack. I'm a ballet dancer. I'm used to lifting up women above my head, also men. And the bag, I would say, was about 200 pounds. And I was struggling so much to lift it. And I just thought how hard it would be for him to walk around New York City. He lived in the subways, walking up the steps, just a huge bag on his back. But he gave me something to think about. When I have money, spend it wisely. Spend it on things that you really need. Spend it on things that you like, that will really help you. Not things like drugs, not things that you don't need. Next slide, please. All right, so the last one was the Far Rockaway Beach Food Organization. This day, me and Mama drove up to the Rockaways. I love the Rockaways. And it was, instead of a soup kitchen, this was more an assembly line where we gathered different foods and put them into different boxes. And I was told that people were waiting here since 9. We gave out food at 12. And my job was to give out carrots. And this one mom came through. This is kind of during the end of it. So one mom came through. She was holding a big box, and the box like was about to rip. And I felt really bad. She looked so stressed out. And I looked outside, and the rest of her family was outside. They weren't helping her out. So it was just her getting all this food. And she had a ticket, and the ticket means that she got double the food. So I helped in. I helped her with the box, and this shows how much she really means, how much family means to her, because she's doing everything for her family. Next slide, please. All right, so in this picture we can see, this is from 1983 to 2016, how as time kept going, the number of homeless people each night grew. And it grew because people are losing their jobs these days because people can't pay their taxes and things for, like, money is rising. Things are getting more expensive. For example, the subway, it went from, like, I think $2 and now it's $2.75, and that's a really big change. Next slide, please. So what you can do to help. First one is donate money to organizations. An example is New York Cares. If you go on their website, the first thing that pops up is a donation. A big box says donation. So it's pretty helpful. The second one was donating items, new or used items, to the United War Veterans Council. This is a program where United War Veterans help, and they call it recycling. You give them clothes, they use those clothes, they give them to people who actually need them. And number three is volunteer work. This is what I did with New York Cares. And basically, you go to the New York Cares program, and there's different things you could do. For example, You could help out at homeless shelters. You could help people rebuild houses from sandy wreckages. You could paint murals, and you just make New York City a better place. Next slide, please. All right. And small things can make a great change. You don't have to do big things that take a lot of work. You just do one small thing, and it makes a big change. Next slide, please. All right, so believe it or not, like I said, I've been coming ethical for my whole life. I'm adopted from India, and the first thing we did when I came here is to come right to this area. And from the start, from my first day, this place, ever since like I started coming into now, it's just grown on me. It's become my home. I've had so many amazing, fun, and happy memories here. From my first teacher, Audrey, to Otis, Simba, and Leah, all my teachers, everyone here, just have a place in my heart. And I've learned so much. I remember doing gun control projects. I remember learning about climate change, doing the really big march in Manhattan. There was a lot of people. It was crazy. And I feel like ethical has changed me as a person. I used to be really immature. I talked a lot in classes. I'd be kicked out of classes and go sit in platform, which I never really like platform. And I'd kick balls and break windows. If you go out in the court and look up, there's a window that's still broken. But throughout these whole years, I've been able to find myself, and I was able to build confidence and grow into a man. And ethical is like another family for me. And I've had hard times in life during school. I'm not able to be myself because people judge. People judge you, and they don't take you as for who you are. But when I come here, I can be myself, and people accept, and I just love it here. And love is an intense feeling of deep affection, and I love ethical, and I'm gonna miss it. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much to all of our presenters, Tyler, Jahai, Zane, Lachlan, and Cece. Thank you. We're actually going to ask the graduates to pull their chairs up here in front and give you, the audience, an opportunity to ask them a couple of questions about their project, if there's any burning questions in your mind or anything you're interested to know about their experience. So for the sake of time, we're gonna limit it to two questions per presenter. But we can pop around in different orders. So I'm gonna pull this around. Would anybody like to start with a question for any of our graduates about their projects? Okay.
How long did it take you guys? Have you been working on them for 2 years or 1 year, or how long did it take you all?
How long did it take you to work on your project? Does anybody want to jump in and?
Well, I started mine, January. But this whole year, we've been preparing for it. And for me, I think it's just been since I've been starting coming. Like, I think it's helped me. I started in January. So that's about like 4 months I've been working on it, and I put it all together into this presentation.
Any other questions? Yes.
I can speak loud. Okay. Jahai, I really enjoyed your presentation. I think a lot of people have a misconception about a lot of rap that it's all bad. And I wonder, it's kind of a comment, but I wonder if you think there would be an audience for parents even to make a list or produce something that would show parents and young kids who want to listen but maybe don't know how to differentiate one from another. And I'm wondering, it sounds like you figured it out by trial and error, but I'm wondering what you think of that idea.
A common theme with a lot of the better rappers, as I like to call it, is that if, with the exception of maybe Kendrick Lamar, they don't have a lot of chart success. Like, they're popular, but they never really hit the mainstream. They don't get radio play. They don't get their hits aren't on Billboard. Nothing like that. So that's always kind of a hit or miss, because sometimes an artist is just, well, bad. But for the most part, like most of those artists don't have like any hits, no radio play, nothing like that. If that's like any sort of way to differentiate them.
I have the
Is there a question in the back there? Okay, right here.
I'm curious for all of you, how did you influence each other in terms of maybe the projects you picked or support each other in making your projects come alive?
So how did you support each other? Do you want to take that one too, Jai?
So actually when I saw CC's project on like feminism and punk, I thought like I was kind of like teetering on doing like, you know, homelessness, police brutality, but when I saw that you could actually like go that far and take a shot in the dark and actually like explore a topic in music, I kind of just thought, I love hip hop. I've been listening to it for a while. Why not put my own opinions in the music that I want to listen to?
Yes.
I very much appreciated the projects, and we've heard appreciations of ethical. I wondered if you could tell us, anybody or everybody, something your family did that made a difference in keeping your heart open. I feel like it's a lot of people are closing their hearts, but what is it that your parents did that made you maybe a little more open-hearted than a lot of people around you?
Does anyone want to take that? Lachlan.
I just want to say my family have motivated me. It's kind of hard to explain, but like it's just the way just to come home and to be with them, it just made me motivated to be myself and to do this, to talk in front of all of you, and yeah, motivation.
Okay, we'll take two more questions. Kelly.
I have a question for Cece. Do you think that punk will impact your life and might be a career of yours when you're older?
I hope so. I would like that a lot. I know it will definitely impact my life because it's impacted my mindset, but if it becomes a career, that would be really nice. But I was reading an interview with the lead singer of the Dead Kennedys, and he was like, I'm not looking for everyone to become punk musicians. I'm looking for everyone to become punk people. If you want to be an investment banker and that's your dream and you can be like a punk rock investment banker, then I'm happy with my job.
Okay, we'll take one more question. Anybody? Okay, Rebecca.
So thanks. I love how culture was focused by two of you around music, and then actually three of you, including Tyler, really spoke about large social issues. So I'm wondering if amongst yourselves what conversations you may have had that bring up the need for equity and social justice and against climate change and how culture plays an impact. And I'll just say that we had a Black Lives Matter platform, and Rita read words of Tupac, which were really great because there's an elder who said, wow, when I slowed down and really listened to his words, it was all about justice. So I'm curious, really, the interplay of culture to social change.
You want to? That's a tough one. Okay, well, I think we're gonna move on here. So thank you so much for the questions. Thank you to our graduates. You guys can go ahead and put your seats back into the audience. And thank you to the parents that raised these incredible children. And we all have really busy lives here in New York, and it takes a lot of effort to get here on Sundays and to bring your kids over the years and to be part of this community. So a lot of what you've seen today, you can thank the parents later for raising future citizens of our world. So with that note, I want to invite the parents to come up for this portion, and the parents decided they wanted to all do this together because it's hard. and they're all going to come up and say a little something about each of the graduates. So,
hi, everyone. My name is Beverly, and I'm Tyler's grandmother. And I'm going to invoke grandparents' privilege for like unabashed bragging And Tyler's been through some difficult challenges and circumstances this year, but through it, he has maintained his very special personality. He's cheerful, he's funny, he's bright, he's very thoughtful and considerate, and he has a really big heart. You know, when it comes time for him to choose what he's gonna do in life, when he has to make some decisions, it's gonna be really hard because he has so many talents and interests. You saw some of his artwork, he's an artist, but he has lots of other things that he likes to do. I'm really proud of the topic that he chose, and I'm really proud of him. And Tyler, I love you.
Hi, we're Zane's parents, Janine and Willie. And I'll just say some words that we thought of together, and Willie's just going to provide some sound. Some good music. So today is time to put my glasses on. So it's really exciting to be among you all here today. Acknowledging our son Zane at Ethical Culture is something we have looked forward to. Many of you know we have a pretty big family, for city standards, anyways. And when people discover we have 5 children, we are often asked, how many girls? How many boys? When they hear that we have 4 girls, the next question inevitably is, so the boy was the last one. And we always know when we're asked this question that they're projecting that all along we were searching for a boy. It's a pretty blasé reaction from me when I say, no, he's number 4 and there's another girl after him. He is number 4 and he is a boy, but he is not defined by either of those characteristics. To us, he is Zane, and he is many more things to us. Zane is trustworthy and caring. Zane has clear convictions. He is creative. Zane is an artist, a fabricator, a costume designer, a fencer, and a friend. He is insightful and genuine. He knows how he wants to complete things, and he can be stubborn. Sorry, Zane. Zane's first grade teacher at the Brooklyn New School, a woman who greatly appreciated his artistic skill, taught me about the positive effects of stubborn. How it can compel one to finish or complete, to push and pursue until the objection is met. Incidentally, this helped Zane greatly during first grade math. One of the profound things that happen to you when you are a parent is not only the direct influence and impact you have on your child via their development, but the role of bearing witness to the development of the person. It washes over you like water, like a river. Sometimes it's still and constant, and sometimes it's fast and furious, sometimes erratic, cutting new paths through the rock. This particular aspect of parenting, the witness bearer, grows the relationship and stretches and bonds you. We are grateful to be able to share so many experiences with Zane, to continue to know him and to grow with him. We look forward to all and any time we should have to know him further. Zane, we will continue to guide and nurture your creative, insightful character to foster your ability to make independent, ethical decisions. We hope that you will always be able to be who you are and live a full and healthy life. You can also know that we will always support your efforts as best we can. Our hopes and dreams are that you will be able to live your life and the ethical cultural principles you have learned here. And I want to personally thank all the teachers that Zane has known since he came here as an infant. Tracy, Audrey, Simba, Leah, Otis, all of them were incredible, dedicated teachers. Thank you.
Way to go, Zane. Jahai's name comes from the Yoruba culture, and it means dignity. We chose that name because we wanted something that he could grow into. With the help of the wonderful teachers here at Brooklyn Society for Ethical Culture, who have taught him what it means to value ethics and to move through the world as an ethical person. Now that you are able to choose to embrace the values of ethics you have learned here, we hope with all our hearts that as you venture out into the world, you remember to walk the walk with the values of ethical culture in your heart. We love you very much.
And then the last thing I'll say was to just say a little bit about seeing the evolution of CC's project and how amazing it was to watch it, you know, again, figuring out what it was going to be about. And sometimes, you know, someone just needs a little spark. So I'll share what that little spark was on this. So she'd been toying with the idea of feminism in punk, and but we didn't know, you know, it was hard to gain access to people to talk to. And another sense of community comes through dogs and our pets. So I was out with our dog one day, and I was talking to another woman who has a dog, a little, I don't know, what is he, like a little puffy little white dog named Iggy. And it suddenly hit me like, oh, he's probably named after Iggy Pop. And this woman is my age. And so I said, oh, you have a dog named Iggy and you're my age. Do you know anything about women and punk? And she said, I do, in fact. And we started talking, and she then connected us to these women that Cece mentioned, these two women who had been the videographers in CBGBs during the 70s and whose collection is available at NYU. And from there, Cece just took off. And it was really amazing to see people like Marissa Prater-Noster Skyping into our office at home, and how Cece handled herself, and to hear people like Marissa say that speaking to Cece was life-affirming was really amazing. And so that's it. It was really an amazing project, and we're really proud to see it come to fruition. And we're thankful to Ethical Culture for providing the religious home for us over the last 11 years. And for those who don't know, we're moving to Philly at the end of this week. So again, it's sort of like the bookends of our time here.
I wanted to say a few words about Cece also. And Cece, as I thought about what to say to you today, what came to mind are those characteristics I've witnessed in you since you were a very small girl, and those that I've seen emerge as you've grown. And I'd like to talk just briefly about three of them: your groundedness, your passion, and your tenacity. First, your groundedness. It was hard for me to figure out the right word for this trait. In fact, spell check underlined it in red. But what I mean to say is that you have always felt secure in who you are. You've never been one to go along with the crowd. You're comfortable in your own skin. You know what's true for you, and you don't do things simply to get the approval of others. How have I seen this appear in you? Your ability to play by yourself for hours at a time when you were a kid, and now your taste in music, the way you express yourself with your hair and your clothing, and your willingness to take on causes that other people may not agree with. Second, your passion. From the ages of about 4 until 8 or so, you were obsessed with dinosaurs and learned everything you could about them. Then it was wolves, and later the brain. You borrowed your friend Uni's mother's neurology textbook from medical school and devoured it. Now it's your music. You go deep, and your passions are not superficial. Finally, your tenacity and perseverance. You decided you wanted to play soccer after most kids had been playing it for years. You dedicated yourself to the sport. You tried out for YOA, and you didn't make the team. You worked hard all summer, tried out again several months later, and you did make it. Your hard work had paid off. But then, before you went to a single practice, you suffered a concussion. It was heartbreaking for your father and me, but much more so for you. You missed months of school. You couldn't play the drums or soccer for a year. No parent wants to see their child suffer, but we were so impressed with your ability to persevere and now to continue to play drums and soccer, even though we know that your head hurts 24 hours a day. This is a coming-of-age ceremony marking a transition in your experience in this community, our family spiritual community. And traditionally, these ceremonies take place at the same time as physical changes, when children begin to take on the responsibilities of adults. And it also comes at a time when you are going through all kinds of other transitions, moving from your beloved Brooklyn to the unknown of Philadelphia, leaving middle school and beginning high school. The Chinese character for change is a combination of crisis and opportunity. And I know that your groundedness, your passion, and your tenacity will serve you well in these transitions and those you'll inevitably face for the rest of your life. I love you very much.
Hello, my name is Fiona Bonham, and I'm Lachlan Brooks' mother.
And I'm Daniel Lachlan's papa.
So I'd like to congratulate Lachlan and all the Evolving Ethics graduates and their families and say how much I've appreciated the bond that we've got with each other over the last couple of years, and some of us over many years, watching these fine young people who are definitely no longer children. It's a very powerful and moving experience. I also wanted to thank all of the teachers. I think most of them have been named by other parents. I also wanted to acknowledge Jean Rowe and Dupre, who have worked with the children over the years and provided wonderful musical inspiration. And I think you can see that music speaks to the soul of people. And I think that was really nurtured by being able to spend time with very talented musicians. Also wanted to thank the leaders, Liesl, Catherine, and Joan, and all of the families and everyone who's here today to witness this culmination of their ethical culture education. Just thank you for coming. So I want to say, Lachlan, that this is truly a milestone for our family, that, as you mentioned, you've been participating here for 13 years. And during that time, along with the friendships and the fun times, I think you've also absorbed many of the tenets of the ethical humanist movement. I really got to witness your ethical training in action when we volunteered together at the soup kitchens and the food pantries. It was such a pleasure to work alongside you, and just to see how willing you were to engage with the guests, how you eagerly volunteered for any task. I do think we walked in, people would take one look at you, and all the heavy lifting went to you. But you never complained, and I was just so impressed with the interest and honestness, the sort of honest respect that you gave every person who came to that soup kitchen. And at the homeless shelter, where one day we served over 2,000 meals, and it was really hard work. And Lachlan never flagged. He smiled when he gave that first tray, and he smiled when he gave the last tray. Anyway, you showed by your action that you believe every person has intrinsic worth and that they're valued members of our community. And honestly, I don't think that you always extend this value to yourself. And my wish for you, as you go out and become an independent person in this world, is that when you have a self-doubt or when you have very hard choices to make, that in your mind or in yourself, you come back to this, your ethical home, and know that you're always welcome here. Congratulations, Lachlan.
So Lachlan, when you were only 3 years old, you showed us your true colors. You flung yourself off the top bunk of your sister's bunk bed. We were all in the kitchen, and we only knew this from the loud thump and the silence before the scream and the tears. When your mother had calmed you down, you said, "The falling felt great, but the landing really hurt." I don't know anyone else who could take an instant like that and separate it into two distinct components. At three, you were able to notice the difference between the two things. My hope for you is that you continue to be aware and notice my hope for you is that you continue to be aware and notice all that is around you. You live in an amazing time, and there's so much to hurl yourself at. I envy you for all the experiences that lay ahead of you and hope that you can remain aware of all those different experiences and how they're connected. Ethical has given you the tools and tuned your moral compass to help you through that journey, but it's up to you to decide when and how to use them. I just want to remind you that you can lose sight of the big picture by living in the moment, and you can miss the detail of the now by always looking ahead. So it's a fine balance, and I think we're all trying to find it, and I have no doubt that you will as well. So pay attention, revel in the amazingness of what you are, and be kind. Your mother, your sisters, and I have always and will always love you unconditionally. We will be there for you as you swing on this trapeze of life, but your safety net extends beyond your immediate family to your ethical community and to the friends who are here. Knowing that we are all there to support and celebrate your accomplishments, and we're there for you when things don't go as planned, should allow you to leap higher, fall further, and land more gently. We love you.
Now, Beverly, who doesn't like the public speaking, but we're gonna make her do it again.
All the teachers here are wonderful. But the EFC families would like to especially acknowledge Leah. You are a very special person. You're patient and dedicated, and the attention that you've given to Tyler especially, and I'm sure to everybody else, is so appreciated. I'm really glad to be part of this community, and I'm so glad to have met you and to have you in my life and Tyler's life. So we together would like to give you a little something for being who you are and the work that you've done.
Okay. Please join us in thanking Leah.
Thank you. It's been such an honor to be part of this community. I felt welcomed here as a member from my first day of work, and it's really been special to see these kids grow and feel part of your family. So thank you so much. I want to bring Joan and Rebecca up to the microphone now to induct these young adults into membership.
Before we actually do the membership part, I get the great joy of presenting you with your ethical bling bags. And so Tyler, you'll get yours next year when you graduate. And for the other four, the first piece of it celebrates the uniqueness of every person and the need to do conflict resolution, sometimes on the fly. So here are the four bling bags. And I have a quick story to tell about the star thrower. And it's one of my favorite ethical stories and one that I love to do at coming of age. Lauren Isley, a scientist, tells the story of the star thrower. He tells of going out on a beach late at night, a beach in which starfish wash ashore. All along the beach, people are taking starfish and dropping them into pots of boiling water to boil away the flesh, leaving the hard starfish body for sale to tourists and others. All along this beach, the man passes campfires with these kettles of death. And at the end of the beach, he sees another man picking up the starfish and tossing them out to sea one by one. "What are you doing?" "I am throwing them back out where they might survive." "But why? Most of them are going to be caught in the undertow, will come back in and die anyway." "Why bother?" he asked as the man threw out another starfish. "Because," came the reply, "this one might survive." And he tossed the starfish as far as he could out to sea. In life, in ethical life, you can't save everyone and you can't do everything, but you can try and do what you are, what is in your power to do. And so the first gift we have for you is a starfish. And so the second thing I have for you is actually this book. Thomas Jefferson, well, before I say that, when I was a kid, I was really jealous of all my Christian and Jewish friends because they all got fancy Bibles when they did coming of age ceremonies. And we didn't have one. And so I found this wonderful quote one time from Ralph Waldo Emerson, who said, "Make your own Bible. Select and collect all the words and sentences that in your reading have been like the blast of triumph out of Shakespeare, Seneca, Moses, John, and Paul." And I think we'd add Susan and Sojourner and others too. This is a book with some collected quotes. It is a loose leaf to symbolize that you can change it through your life and figure out what inspires you. And one of the selections in it is the Star Thrower story. Now, because we know that one of the important things in social justice is empowerment, we're giving you something very useful here, which are a couple of charging cables. And because we believe in diversity, one is for Apple and one is for Android. And may you always experience empowerment. And to remind you that the light you bring increases if you share it, I'm going to offer you some candles. And also, to fit ethical culture, you all got four different colors to remind you of the uniqueness of all. And finally, one of the most important things is your handy dandy ethics detector. You know, my mother always used to say that the best ethical guideline is, can you look yourself into the at yourself in the mirror after you've done something? So here is your ethics detector. Okay, so Rebecca, you want to come up and do the last piece of this?
So, a very hard act to follow. Detect your ethics by look in the mirror. I recently saw probably a meme on Facebook with a similar reference to the mirror that said, this is your enemy. Get up in the morning, look at your enemy and say, I will not be brought down, and then turn that face around. So you can be your own worst enemy by having no faith in yourself, and you can have a whole lot by saying, I can do it. So by virtue of graduating with the coming of age, you become an honored member of the Brooklyn Society for Ethical Culture. So we want to welcome our new four new members with a rah-rah. Thanks. And we are delighted to have you. That means you become a voting member at the age of 18. You can even be on the board. You can be on committees, or you can just show up as you want, as many of our children have and do as they go into the world. We have each a book for each of you. It's The Alchemist. And I know when I was 14, reading was a challenge for me, and I didn't read it till much later, but it's appropriate at any age. So I want you to read it, enjoy it, read it later, enjoy it later. But the story really is a coming-of-age story of someone who sojourns and finds themselves in some ways they never had to walk away from the mirror. Give a special shout out to Cece and her family. Thank you, Alec and Lisa and Milo as well, having you as members, both very active in our governance and our processes as adults, and watching your children grow has been an honor. It's always hard when somebody leaves our community in any way, but to move, it's good for you and we'll miss you. So I wanted to really give a real appreciation to what you've all contributed.
Okay. And we have a certificate of membership for each of the graduates that I'm going to give to them now.
Okay. I knew there was something else. Thank you, Leah. Also, a shout out to Simba, because she was doing the nursery program as she always does, and some of these children were in her first class. And she's seeing her first students graduate. I'm looking around the room and I see so many members, people who've been around for a long time, and so many people I don't recognize who are probably the guests, your guests. It's a lot of fun to be together over years with each other and to watch our children go through different episodes. So I remember when Lachlan's family came to visit me in Maine before Lachlan was adopted, and we did the family photo so we could send it to the adoption agency. And that was a long, long time ago. So there's really just a lot of continuity that happens. We all remember reaching out when Cece had her concussion and hoping things would go well, and empathize with a trip from Washington Heights on almost a weekly basis, my place of origin. So. And watching a family of five become five from, I think, when you first joined, it was three. Three children, maybe, when you first came around. I remember the births kept happening.
Atlantic and Pacific Coast, the Great Lakes and the Gulf of Mexico, the land between sustains us all. Chariot. It's our tireless call. Thank you. from the poplar tree. With an old coat hanger in a room somewhere. A trail of tears and inaccurate hair.
Our